Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to this HEPI and London South Bank University webinar to launch the 2024 English Social Mobility Index. I'm Rose Stevenson, Director of Policy and Advocacy at the Higher Education Policy Institute, also known as HEPI. And we're really thrilled to publish such an important piece of work again, and we're joined by esteemed colleagues this morning to discuss the findings. So this is an annual index. It's compiled by London South Bank University, and it was first published in 2021. It compares the performance of English higher education providers and measures the social mobility of graduates. The index measures the social distance graduates have travelled and the proportion of graduates who have made that journey. It combines access, continuation, and outcome measures for undergraduates on all modes of study, other than apprenticeships. So let me tell you a little bit about how today's event will work. To start, we will hear from Professor David Phoenix, Vice-Chancellor of London South Bank University and CEO of the LSBU Group. And David is going to present the results of the 2024 index to us. We will then hear from our panel on their responses to the index. Our panel consists of John Blake, Director of Fair Access and Participation at the Office for Students, Professor Shirley Congdon, Vice-Chancellor at the University of Bradford, and Professor Lee Elliott Major, Professor of Social Mobility at the University of Exeter. Our panellists will have 5 minutes each to present their responses, and colleagues, I do ask you to stick to time as we want to leave plenty of opportunity for questions. So at around 12:30, we will have time for questions. So for those of you who are listening along, please do post your questions in the Q&A box on your screen and also upvote the questions that you would like to be asked. Emma is in the background doing the tech, and Emma will be able to unmute your mic in turn to ask you your questions. We encourage that. It's nice to have your participation and hear your voices. But if that doesn't work for you, just let me know in your question and I will read it out for you. I need to let you know that the event is being recorded, and also everything that is said today is on the record. We probably have some media colleagues watching along. Hello, folks. And I do encourage you to speak as freely as you can. So without further ado, let me hand over to David, who is going to present this year's results. David.
Thank you, Rose. And it's great to be here and great to continue the partnership with HEPI around the index. Just to give some context, the index came about as I was setting up LSBU Group, because within the group, as well as the university, we have colleges and academies. And we align what we do very much with employment sectors, which means we were less interested in the entry of students, but more what they achieved while they were with us. And whilst we had things like Progress 8 scores within the academies, we couldn't find a similar measure that we could use for universities. So the concept was quite simple, that we would look at IMD 1 and 2, and that we would look at those groupings, see what kind of volume was going into universities, but recognizing it's not just how many students you recruit from lower socioeconomic groups, it's what they achieve. And therefore, we chose to look at continuation and positive outcomes and graduate salaries. And what I liked about the approach was that whilst it's not intended to address every answer, it provided us with some insights into a range of organisations. So within the institutions that were performing most strongly on this measure, we had newer institutions like Bolton, which again is in the top 10 this year. But we also had institutions like King's and LSE that were performing really strongly. So what it was trying to pull out was discussion around the fact that social mobility shouldn't be seen as something just certain types of institution do, but it should stimulate discussion within institutions about how does that fit with your mission, and how do we know we're performing well beyond just talking about recruitment, which actually is perhaps a relatively poor metric. So whilst it doesn't attempt to cover everything, it attempts to stimulate that debate. And it's been really pleasing to see the amount of feedback we've had from colleagues from across the sector. And we've tried to adapt the methodology while we can based on that feedback. So last year, one of the key challenges was around graduate starting salaries and the need for regional weighting. So that was the main change we brought in this year. And what that's meant is that a number of the London universities that performed quite well have performed less well when you take into account that weighting. So some institutions like City and LSE are still there around the top 10. A few others like King's are now just outside the top 10. And we've seen improvements, especially in areas like the Midlands. So if you look at the West Midlands, areas like Wolverhampton, Birmingham City, and Newman are performing exceptionally well, which then starts to enable us perhaps to pose some questions about why are we seeing these regional variations. We've still got in the top spots Aston and Bradford, and I find that really interesting given their history as colleges of technology many years ago, and therefore the fact that we know from global work that institutions that focus on those employment aspects often attract people who are interested in social mobility. But also to have achieved those results, there must be system-wide changes that they're looking at to get the outcomes that they're getting across the piece. Especially if you look at, for example, Bradford, where there's about 84, 85% of their students from these lower quintiles. So overall, what I'm hoping is that the index continues to stimulate debate. When Secretary of State wrote out to universities recently about the fee increase, one of the first things she indicated was they expect universities to play a stronger role in expanding success and improving outcomes for disadvantaged students. And it was really pleasing to see that and the focus on outcomes. And I hope that the index continues to allow people to look at their mission, their mix of activity, and then look at other comparators and how they're performing on this measure. Not to say that there's a single answer, but to perhaps facilitate more debate within clusters of institutions about how we can continue to improve the outcomes for some of the most disadvantaged in society. So thank you all for attending, and thank you for the continued interest in the index and for the support from HEPI.
Great. Thank you so much, David, for explaining the index to us. We are going to move over to our panel and hear their responses to the index and this year's results. So, John, over to you first, please.
thank you very much, Rose. So my name is John Blake. I'm the Director for Fair Access and Participation at the OFS, the Regulator for Higher Education in England. And the vast majority of my role is around everything Dave's been talking about, is trying to encourage institutions, to widen their intake of students from disadvantaged and historically underrepresented backgrounds. But as Dave says, increasingly to recognise that there aren't prizes here for just opening the door to students and then not supporting them to succeed. And it is, I think, notable that I've been doing this job now for 3 years. I think there's been there was already quite a significant shift in the sector before I joined the regulator, but there were still patches of people who would say, but you know, we're really good because we take in students who others wouldn't take in. So if they don't succeed, that's not our fault. And I think what's so clear here is that yes, there are lots of challenges, and we know that poor prior attainment or poor prior experience of education can be a real barrier for students to succeed, and universities and colleges don't have infinite resources or capacity to to challenge all of those underlying issues, but that there really are places that are outstanding in how well they understand the students they're taking in, think carefully about the particular challenges those students have, and support them to achieve and succeed into the future. And I think that's it's great to see that conversation gaining much more wide coverage. I think, salary metrics are always very interesting. One of the challenges often made to the OFS is, you know, how dare you rank institutions by salary? And we keep pointing out that we don't. That's not one of our metrics for our conditions, partly because of the challenges of regional weighting and various things like that, but also because we recognise that students don't just go into higher education for the purposes of achieving a more highly paid career in the future. But equally, as a former school teacher, I can also say very firmly that was what a lot of the students that I educated, particularly from disadvantaged backgrounds, were looking for. So I think having that eye on, yes, the wider impact of higher education and the inherent benefit of feeling more educated or engaging with a topic that fascinates you, but also making sure that people are being equipped for lifelong success and employment, I think is really powerful and important. I think just to pick out two points that struck me very strongly from looking at these results. I think the first is that I'm not surprised Bradford is up there at the top. I recently had the chance to visit the University of Bradford, and I often tell the story when people sort of ask about, you know, what is it that you pick up when you go out to the institutions? And clearly, you know, you could spend hundreds of hours visiting any single institution that we regulate and still not know everything there is to know about them. So when we visit for a day or for two, it's, you know, it's really important to maximize what you're learning about the institution. And one of the things I always look for is the interplay between the staff that I'm introduced to and how well they understand the different work that each other is engaged in. Because I think across particularly our larger universities, there's a sort of infinite variety of activities going on at any one moment in time, and many of them will probably be relatively effective, but they will all be more effective if they're leveraged together. And what really struck me visiting the University of Bradford was the extent to which, when I sat in a room with the various project leaders of the parts of Bradford's Access and Participation Plan, which we approve, was not just how passionate they spoke about their own work, but how clear-eyed and thoughtful and reflective their understanding of the work of others around the table was. So I think it's that whole institution approach in which people are really reinforcing what everyone's doing, and that people have the autonomy to make the decisions they need within their particular area, but it's all links together like the strength of an arch as everything leans on each other to make it stronger, and a clear focus on the power and importance of education for the sort of students that Bradford seeks to take and seeks to support. And it was just a genuinely lovely experience just to sort of sit there and have people talk about their expertise and the work they were doing. And particularly, I've made it very much part of our work in access participation. It's the job of universities and colleges applying for an access participation plan isn't to guess what's inside my head. It's to make a clear case for why they think what they're doing is evidence informed, will make a difference, and can make a difference, and how they will know if it does. And I think that's what came through really clearly. So I think and other institutions at the top end of this list, I think about likewise. The other thing I wanted to pick out, and I think is interesting and does pose, I think, challenges for us, is the point about London and the extent to which we can mitigate the overwhelming power of London as the sort of, depending on which way you want to do, the alluring beacon on the edge of the horizon that summons people from across the country, or the drain that pulls everyone in, or the spider's web, or whichever way you want to think about it. I think we've learned a huge amount in the time I've been involved in education about not confusing social mobility with geographic mobility, and not thinking that, you know, the greatest success for young people is how far away they live from their parents, and that by and large, the journey of people in improving their life is to go to a highly selective institution and then move to London. I don't deprecate that. That's what I did, and it was really beneficial for my life. But we want to recognize that there are really important factors about place and supporting places and making sure that other parts of the country are able to benefit from the kind of power of integrated infrastructure and combined economic weight that London has. I think we've still got some way to go in understanding how best to replicate that, but it does seem pretty clear that effective, thoughtful civic leadership from universities and from further education colleges is a really crucial part of that. So I think it's really interesting to see what this list looks like when you balance out for the waiting for London, but also to think about what there is within London that is replicable elsewhere, or what is just completely a function of the ancient role of the capital in England and is not something we can replicate. And I think some really interesting learnings there. But at that point, I will stop.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, John. We're going to hear next from Shirley Congdon. First of all, Shirley, many congratulations. What a wonderful table to come the top of. You must be very proud of your institution and your colleagues and your students. So over to you to hear your thoughts on the index.
Yeah, thank you, Rose. And thank you for inviting me to be on the seminar. I wanted to start off by just referring back to Professor David Phoenix, because I do actually think that this social mobility index is an amazing tool to help us to reflect on the things that we can be doing and what's working. So we can definitely use this in our own institutions, but across the sector as well. And clearly, we are very, very proud of the University of Bradford of being number one on the index for the fourth consecutive year. And it's particularly poignant today for this to be announced, because we're just having one of our graduation ceremonies celebrating our social science students, who equally do pretty well on the job market. I guess a few points, really. I mean, advancing social mobility, even though we didn't call it that when we set our strategy out in 2020, is really a cornerstone of our commitment to help people to prosper in their place and have pride in their achievements. And I guess where we've hooked this in is really our equality, diversity, and inclusion approach. We place a deliberately significant strategic emphasis on equality, diversity, and inclusion, because these three things are intrinsically linked to people's chances of being really able to take the opportunities that universities offer in getting them to engage on programme, to stay on programme, to think about taking the opportunities that we all have. But you've really got to work hard in a connected way to really encourage students to take every opportunity that is there for them. And understanding the significant barriers that many of our students have to take opportunity, it's not that they lack ambition or lack intellect, it's that sometimes they lack confidence. So when we think about the factors that influence social mobility, early childhood experiences, experience of education, geography, parental occupation, and where these things intersect with ethnicity and gender and disability and socioeconomic status, you've really got to see all of that in the round and have a whole systems approach. So what you then need to do with that understanding of all those intersections of factors that influence people, is to do what John said, really, is to make sure that you are working in an institution using a whole systems approach to the support that students get. And at Bradford as well, we're obviously part of West Yorkshire, a devolved authority. There's strong systems working that's starting to emerge from devolution. And we also have a very, very strong approach to system leadership in the city. So that means we are more naturally inclined to work with our schools, with the FE colleges, with community leaders, charities, businesses, in a way that isn't just about going into schools to see if you can hook people in from a young age to try and come to your university. What you've got to focus on is doing the right things for the young people in your place, which is about helping them to be confident. You know, we all will run things like probably maths programs with our students, where they go and support students in schools. But the emphasis has got to be on the individual students in schools, in their communities, in the FE colleges, and have this whole systems approach. The other thing I wanted to mention was culture and heritage, which is really, really important drivers of social mobility. and to understand culture and heritage and aware that the people in our universities understand that we appreciate that culture is different and heritage is different. So as a strategic partner for Bradford 2025, City of Culture, and being instrumental in helping the bid to be successful, we're really using this as an opportunity to engage our students in more placemaking and storytelling about their narratives, their sense of belonging, which can then equally help us to understand how we can support students on programme. This year, we were also named University of the Year for Social Inclusion at the Social Mobility Awards. And all of these things that sort of incrementally are happening, I do believe, is because our approach is intentional at every stage. We're consciously inclusive that every programme, every project board, every change we try to make has got to be focused on how we get our students engaged, actively enjoying learning and feeling confident that they can prosper and, you know, stand the test of interviews, etc., etc. Now, I could read out a whole list of things that we do, and a lot of people might say, yeah, well, we do those. I think it's how we do these things together and how we are committed to keeping this at our centre of our strategy that's important. The last thing that I wanted to mention is I do welcome the Secretary of State's point about social mobility is as important as it ever. It's going to be more important than ever, actually, because what we're seeing is job densities being very different in different cities. And as a key city in the UK, we are, you know, acutely aware that job densities are higher in the core cities. And we've really got to keep our eye on how we work in strategically with inward investment to grow the economy so that the job density in Bradford and cities like Bradford is stronger. I think I see that as a particular important thing, not just the salaries, but the amount of jobs. So that's the key things I wanted to cover, Rose.
That's great. Thank you so much, Shirley. Hopefully we can pick up on some of your points in the Q&A as well. Okay, finally, we will hear from Lee Elliott Major. Over to you, Lee.
Thanks very much. Great to be part of this debate, and congratulations to Bradford and Aston for topping the rank. It was lovely actually hearing Shirley talk about some of the work that Bradford's doing. I just want to offer a few final comments, I guess, and some maybe some, a bit of challenge as well in terms of how we develop the index. I mean, I've always welcomed it, as David knows, because I think that we need to really think about social mobility, social justice, however you want to frame it, really seriously, front and central in the higher education sector. Too often it is seen as a nice to have and not absolutely central for various reasons, for all the pressures we're under as a sector. So a couple of things I would say. One is we have to be really careful of how we frame social mobility. And, you know, my principle, the sort of principle that governs my work, is that background shouldn't determine what you do, whatever you choose to do in life. Okay. So while earnings are absolutely important, as John was saying, I do think we need to think about how we develop these types of social mobility indexes or rankings so that we do value and acknowledge those young people that come into our institutions, that go on to do local jobs, that go on to do jobs like teaching or social work that are incredibly valuable to wider society, and not just those that go on to earn higher salaries. I know there are attempts to sort of balance the rankings in respect to this, but I'm not sure we are doing as much as we could do. And maybe we need to complement the next rankings with some maybe case studies of what institutions are doing for their local communities. So I think we need to present our social mobility efforts as much more broad than perhaps that sort of, you know, that notion of social mobility is a very individualistic thing where you're catapulting someone from a disadvantaged backgrounds into the elites. So I know all of you, well, actually, it would be interesting. So I think most of you would agree with that. But I just think we need to be careful in that we don't emphasize, because of lack of data, a particular view of social mobility. Another point to this, I would say, is that, and everyone's mentioned Bridget Phillipson's challenge to the sector, quite rightly challenging us on our contributions to social mobility, I think we are going to win the argument, or hopefully win the argument, if we, again, couch social mobility in a much broader idea of contributing to our local communities, as well as helping the individuals that come to our institutions. So very passionate about, for example, using undergraduates as tutors and thinking about service learning, how our students contribute to wider society. So I suppose what I'm saying is, I love this index in that it shines a spotlight on social mobility, but we just have to be really sure about what we mean by that. And in my view, it has to be this broader sort of conceptualization of what we mean by it. A few things, and David's heard me say these things as well, and he'd be well versed in these debates. There are data limitations here, and I know we are using the best data we've got, but I think we should be aware of these. So we're using postcode type data for disadvantage. There are all sorts of caveats to using that. We hopefully one day be able to use individualized sort of background data. And by the way, disadvantage isn't just about free school meals. It's broader than that. So I think you just have to be careful with the conclusions of these rankings. And again, there are caveats to the way that we are classifying outcomes here with an emphasis obviously on earnings. I've sort of covered that. So, you know, I suppose I wonder, having been involved in rankings and LITO was over many years, is whether we should move to what Dave was saying earlier about looking at clusters of institutions, maybe categorizing those that have broadly been doing well in broader categories. I suppose I'm not completely convinced that we justify that with the data limitations we have those individual rankings, but perhaps we can open that to discussion. So overall, I really welcome this because, you know, we haven't had these debates previous to this. I wish that these rankings index would be central to some of the newspaper rankings that are so influential. But yeah, I hope we can evolve these rankings in a really constructive way to help demonstrate what the sector is doing already in this really important area. So really looking forward to discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lee, for your interesting reflections and some challenge as well. So if I could ask all speakers to pop their cameras back on. And I wondered if, David, we could perhaps just come to you first before we jump into the Q&A. I wondered if you wanted to respond to some of Lee's comments there.
Yeah, and I think what I should have emphasised for those that haven't read the detail and the methodology, I am committed to looking at outcome measures. And what we've sought to do is weight two things. One is positive outcomes, the other is median salaries. So we have tried to look more broadly at positive destinations, not just salary levels, for all the reasons that Lee says. We had been approached at one point about the possibility of this entering into some of the league tables. It's something I am more reticent about because no methodology is perfect. And the purpose behind this at the outset was to try and shine a light on good practice and stimulate that debate within the sector. It was meant to be a tool that could allow us to generate questions within organisations about, well, why, if this is our peer, and got a similar mission and mix to us, why are they scoring more highly in terms of how some of these disadvantaged students progress? And I think that could be damaged by starting to make it a kind of formalized reputational ranking in that way. I think the work that HEP is doing is a good way forward. I think this question on clustering that Lee raised, and John touched on actually as well, is interesting to some extent. This is probably more of an OFS query rather than an LSBU query. But the fact we are seeing some clusters of institutions in areas of the country doing well, and it's not solely driven by salaries. We've managed the salary aspect by looking at regional variation. And it does raise in my mind these questions of if you have a number of institutions within a region that are all performing better than average, is it something that region is facilitating? Is there some kind of forum or something going on within those regions that are stimulating debate or supporting transition? because it's not just what happens in the university, it's supporting students there. So I think looking at clusters, both clusters in terms of performance, clusters though in terms of perhaps regional outcomes, could be an interesting project, slightly beyond what we've got capacity for, I think, at LSBU, but I think it's an interesting concept.
I just picked that up, Rose, very briefly, just to say I think Ben's actually right. I mean, having worked in schools, I think one of the great recurrent themes of all my time in schools was, you know, why can't we do for the rest of the country what London Challenge did for London? And the answer turned out to be because London's London and we don't really know how to do that. And we're not really entirely certain why London Challenge worked, but almost certainly had something to do with the demography and the way it shifts together. And I do think there's right, we need to look at these things closely, but, you know, not to bang my favourite drum of evaluation endlessly, but I do think there's a lot here about understanding the unique circumstances. I think one of the things we've learned in the last 20 years is that policy shopping internationally doesn't work, because it turns out there are things to learn, obviously, and we should always be keen to learn, but there are often also deep, long-standing features of other nations that explain why they've ended up structured in the same way. And I think we should be open to the idea that some of those things are similarly placed in different regions of the UK. It doesn't mean we can't change them, doesn't mean we shouldn't think about them, but I think it means we should be very cautious about jumping to any conclusions about what precisely it is that does that. That said, one of my armchair jumping to conclusions things would be, I think it is interesting when you see regions where you have in particular, a very strong, generally highly selective institution and a very strong, civically focused recruiting institution, both seem to be doing better. I think there's 10 tons of work that needs to be done on ascertaining even whether that is correct rather than just my rough approximation. But, you know, whenever I've tried to look at that, it does seem that sort of, and I think there's something there about trying to think, you know, what is the optimum structure for areas, particularly those outside London, because London has hundreds of institutions, but again is unique in that sense rather than elsewhere. And I think trying to understand that, but also I think increasingly the interplay with regional government. I mean, it's pretty clear this government, I mean, all governments for the last 20 years have been in some sense committed to greater devolution, but this government does seem quite strongly committed to greater regional thinking and expanding particularly the directly elected mayoral system over quite wide regions. And clearly that must be something we have to play into our thinking and try and think about how those units can support us. But also, you know, what is the natural unit? And that it might be very different in different parts of the country depending on what kind of institutions they have. I mean, one of the most notable things I thought when I first started, my first set of visits was up to the Northeast. And it's fascinating there. And again, this is a rough generalization, but if you look at the distribution of commuter students for all of the Northeastern universities, they generally, people will travel a very long way east-west. It turns out people in the Northeast will go a very long way before they will cross one of the rivers and go north and south. And, you know, people can make of that what they will. But, you know, there's quite strong trends there. And some of them are, you know, I don't think they're deeply cultural. I think in many cases they just do with transport links. But there's a lot there that we need to think about and we need to play with as we try and work out how to replicate some of the successes that we've seen.
Great, thank you. So I will read out our first question, as it is anonymous, and it's related to this question of regions. The question says, in conjunction with recent government and OFS announcements regarding regional objectives and outcomes, is there any plan to try and map where in the UK students lived prior to going to university, where they lived post-graduation, and weighting their outcomes according to the job market of the region they lived in? So I think this is a little bit of what you've picked up this year, David, in the index in terms of your methodology. So I don't know if you maybe want to give us a bit more detail on that.
I think this is one that Lee may be interested in as well, because of his quite correct assertion that some of the postcode analysis isn't ideal in terms of polar data. And I think that this is adding another layer of complexity. I mean, what it's suggesting is that rather than looking at the income based on where the student ends up, which is what we've tried to do, take that back a stage to see where was the student, where did the student originate from? I'm not off the top of my head sure how we would be able to triangulate that data from the data sets we've got. And I'm also wary about turning it into a cottage industry. So I could see why that's an interesting question. I'm not sure it's one we would pick up in another iteration of the index, but this is an area Lee's probably got more experience of in terms of aspects of those geographical movements.
Yeah, I think it's really challenging, David, actually. And I was sort of thinking about, because I do think place and region is really important to what John was speaking about. So I was just thinking from a Southwest perspective, we've now set up this social Southwest Social Mobility Commission, and that is a collaborative, ultimately, scheme involving not just universities, but further education colleges, schools, and actually businesses and the workplace. To think about what are the specific obstacles in that part of the country. And there are different, and there are some similarities with the Northeast in terms of distance and rurality and all those things. And I do think as a sector, this doesn't answer this question, but I think it's just this really interesting regional question we're circling around. I do wonder whether we could be better at sort of putting forward towards that opportunity mission that the government is talking about. What is the sort of regional efforts that we could think about for our institutions that sort of contextualize, if you like, where they are? So the London effect, as John was saying, is fascinating. And the work I do with schools, the more I suppose I think I'm challenging schools to improve on their equity, I would call it, in the school system, but also giving some sort of sense of what their particular context is. And I think we need to sort of come to that somehow. But I would love to think that we could all have a regional sort of effort around social mobility or opportunity, how you want to frame it, because they are different, that they are different in the different regions. And certainly London is very different. We could have a whole session on London. So not answering that specific question, I think that there would be data constraints around that, but I would love to go to more individualized data on income background. I think it'd be really difficult to go to place, but as a whole, I'd really support a more regional approach to this area.
I think, Rose, if I could just come in there. I mean, I alluded to the fact that in Yorkshire, the 12 Yorkshire universities have worked collaboratively to bring out things like inclusive employer guides for employers all over Yorkshire. We have a mayoral graduate scheme that's been brought about through the influence of Yorkshire universities. So education and skills has got a much more connected focusing with FE and HE. But within the region and within the sub-regions, there's obviously massive differences, even in Bradford. So we get to Bradford BD24 versus BD1-7. The level of that difference in social mobility is huge. So there's also something about what Lee's saying there about the schools. Now, if you looked at the school attainment in Bradford, it's not particularly good. It's getting better, but it's not good. When we get students into the FE colleges, they start to thrive and their attainment improves. And then we see a better run through when we get students into the universities. So there's a number of different factors where you could look at a region from a meta level, but you've also got to have your eye on both ends of the telescope, because there's so much variation within the sub-regions that you need to understand that as well and have particular interventions for those sub-regions.
Really interesting. Thank you. The questions are flooding in, so we're going to move to a concise answer format. So Lucy has a question. Emma, if you can unmute Lucy for me, please. Go ahead, Lucy.
I just wondered if there's any expertise on the panel in how the UK ranked in the world for social mobility via higher education, even just compared with, say, English-speaking nations, Australia, America, and so on and so forth. But how do we rank in the world? Does anyone know? We're obviously doing well within the country, and certainly some very well.
So just very quick to come in on that, Rose. I mean, this is stuff, Lucy, I write about a lot. Social Mobility and Its Enemies, published by Penguin 6 years ago, if you want to look at some international comparisons of social mobility.
That's from all good bookshops, Lee, is that?
We know it depends what measures you use, Lucy. And honestly, we could have another debate about all this and whether you use social class, income, etc. If you believe the economists, and I do to some extent, some people would find that quite hard, but no, the economists, if you look at their data, if you look at social mobility as a whole or income mobility, we don't do that well compared to other nations. Us and the United States don't do so well. Australian and Canada do better, the Scandinavian countries, all sorts of debates. And again, what John was saying about, you've got to be really careful with these international comparisons. A lot of that is around culture. It's around wider issues than just the higher education sector. There is relatively little evidence that we know around specifically HE. There are some interesting studies which I can send references to after this debate that have looked at the US and UK and looked at individual sort of data and big data. We know less what's happening in other countries. Indeed, I think the Sutton Trust is wanting to commission a study on this. So we don't seem to do that well generally on social mobility, but it does depend on what data you use. But there is less evidence around specifically HE. And the wider point I'd say to you all is, of course, we're all passionate about HE contributing to these social mobility issues, but it can't solve everything. You've got to be really careful. And I'm really glad that the government is at least recognising child poverty, for example. You know, if you're serious about all this, you need to look at that bigger picture. So we are contributing, but we can't solve everything.
John, your quick thoughts, please.
Yeah, just very, very quickly. I just think, I mean, obviously Lee is absolutely right about the difficulty of international comparisons. But I think a point I like to reiterate a lot, having spent a lot of time looking at the kind of international policy shopping that used to go on in schools, is that, you know, England's population alone is larger than that of any single American state. It is larger than the combination of Wales, Scotland, Northern Ireland, Australia and New Zealand all put together. You know, so we run one of the largest unitary education systems in the world, and one of the most diverse in terms of socioeconomic diversity of the population and ethnic diversity of the population. And so I think whilst we should absolutely always be looking to improve, and I think there's a long way to go, I think that it's also worth saying that sometimes when we compare ourselves to some of the Scandinavian countries or places in Asia, or indeed elsewhere, I think we sometimes forget that the sheer complexity of what we're doing, both in terms of demographics and size, is genuinely impressive. And you know, for all that it is my job to spend a lot of time going around to institutions encouraging them to do more on access and participation, I think it's always worth remembering that we are at a baseline where we're doing some really impressive stuff. And it is more likely those countries that currently seem to do better than us, as they begin to diversify demographically or socioeconomically, will end up looking more like us than us looking more like them. And in some ways, what we know about what it takes to build a thriving education system that can integrate, you know, students from vastly different socioeconomic and racial and experiential backgrounds, you know, for all that we've got lots we want to do in that, I think we do know a lot. And actually, I think we should be very proud of what we do know and can do in those terms. And I think I would, you know, taking Lee's caveats, I would still say I'd be pretty confident that we have world-leading practice in quite a number of our institutions about what it takes to really build a genuinely successful, diverse and rigorous higher education system. We just don't have it everywhere.
Great, thank you. We now have a question from Ala. So Emma, if you can unmute Ala. Ala, go ahead, please.
Hi, thanks. This is a sort of left field question. It's really about universities as employers. So in other words, social mobility in terms of the people who are teaching undergraduates and postgraduates, and the pipeline and how that might be affected by a person's ability to fund themselves for certain elements. So I think looking at the whole system, I've asked this question before and I can't find anybody. Is anybody researching this, even crudely?
Sorry, Rose, I don't want to be dominating this discussion, but just very quickly, Alan, I think this is such a good question, because I was going to make this point, a broader point really, is that if we're serious about inclusion, equity, social mobility, whatever, we have to think about this in terms of our staff that we employ as well as the students that we serve. And I find in some areas of the sector that there is this disjoint between the stuff we're trying to do for our students, and then you look at the staffing and it's not as diverse as we would like. So if you're really serious about this stuff and you want it genuinely inclusive cultures, you have to look at the staff. And the and from what I can tell, and again, I can pass on these studies, there's not as many as we'd like, and many of them are outside the UK. Certainly academia is becoming an increasingly privileged profession. There's various reasons for this. And I worry about that, because then that informs the dominant cultures in our institutions. Some institutions are better. And by the way, totally agree with John on this, about I think we have some of the best inclusive institutions, both within higher education and in the school system in the world. Honestly, I do lots of presentation outside the UK. I think we just have very stark inequalities outside the education system. And there is variation. And I always say the secrets are within the system that we have. So it's great to go to other countries. But honestly, I think a lot of the best practices here. But yes, we have to treat socioeconomic background as one of the characteristics we look for when we look at diversity of our own staff. At the moment, it tends to focus quite rightly on ethnicity and gender. I would add socioeconomic background to that agenda to make our institutions genuinely inclusive.
Yeah, I'm going to come to Shirley in a second, but I'm just going to push back on that, Lee, about the concept of kind of social class outside of higher education and that having such a big impact. It does, but I think it's really important that we're clear that that doesn't become erased once you move into higher education, that those structures are very, very visible and alive, both within the student body and the staff body as well. So speaking of the staff body, over to Shirley.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so I think most organisations will be carefully looking at how they can be more inclusive for their staff. I mean, our whole approach is a whole university approach. So our approach to inclusion, equality and diversity transcends the students and the staff, and we're becoming more representative of minority ethnicities in the university. We've openly declared we want to be an anti-racist university. We have a long way to go at the University of Bradford and every other university in the UK and the world, if we're truthful. So to really generate a climate of inclusion where people can be themselves and can, you know, progress in a way that recognises their individual differences, takes a real conscious approach. And you've really got to be very data-driven, but as well as being open to challenge. And really, really open to challenge means you've got to listen to staff and students. And we do an awful lot of this in small groups because it's more effective. Really listening to what are the experiences of the staff and students in our organisation that take account of where they come from, where they could get to, and how we can get them on a better path. But it can be quite painful if you're really, really going to take this seriously, because you've got to listen and you've got to act. And that act requires whole system acting.
Thank you. Okay, we have a question from Johnny Rich next. A very important question. So Johnny, if you could pose your question to the panel, please.
Thanks a lot, Rose. And thanks everybody for your contributions, which have been really fantastic, and for the work in the index. I wanted to ask whether the panel have any reflections on the impediments to social mobility created by the need to earn money alongside studying. Increasingly, I think the data is now that more than 50% of students are working over 15 hours a week. So can we see any patterns in the data that reflect this? Cities where work is more or less available, other differential outcomes and so on?
David, if I can come to you on that one, and then John, I'm going to ask for 30 seconds on how the OFS is going to take into account the impact that will happen to students who work in a long number of hours on their outcomes, which I think inevitably we're going to see. David.
Yeah, so I don't think we've looked at that within the data we've studied, nor do I think that stands out from the table. But there is, Johnny's quite right, a range of data that shows a degree of external work can be beneficial to students up to a certain point. And then past a certain point, you see deterioration of opportunity within education because of the amount of committed time to work. So I think there is data out there. I suppose, to some extent, from my experience of working with our own students, the students that are most likely to undertake more significant numbers of hours work tend to be those that are from lower socioeconomic classes and require the cash to actually just support themselves, or often other family members or other commitments. So whilst I don't think there's anything explicit in our table that stands out, to some extent, maybe by capturing IMD 1 and 2, it should be implicit in that those groups are the ones that tend to require those additional hours.
Just before I I think there's two points I'd like to make. The first point is that the way we account for this, and you can see this in some of the quality reports we've already published, is to ask institutions how well they understand what the working experiences of their students are and whether they've made appropriate adjustments. So I can entirely respect an institution that says, no, we want to be a traditional institution where people turn up to lectures in the morning and then they go to the library in the afternoon. That's great. But if you can't find students who can do that, then that's your problem, and you took them on, and you are responsible for working out how to build your learning around them. And I think things like some sort of compressed timetables and things like that are certainly things institutions should be considering. And I'm sure Dave and Shirley are expert on those sort of things, and I know that's there. The one caveat to that, I think, is that I think it's also part of the regulator's job to be sure that policymakers understand that the kind of student cost of living problems that we're talking about now are not those that they might imagine from 20 or 40 years ago. We are at risk of seeing an entirely class divergent experience of higher education, in which poorer students are working nearly full time and studying full time, and middle class students are not doing so. Government can decide it thinks that's fine if that's what it wants to do. I mean, but it can't pretend that isn't what's happening. And I think it's really important that we have that conversation, because I worry, and I always use this reference, and it dates me immediately, but it does feel to me like some of these conversations about student poverty or student cost of living challenges are had as though students are living some sort of a young one's life, in which, yes, it might be a bit grungy in the flat and they're eating lentils, but they've also got plenty of time to sit around and engage in anarchist poetry and do other things. So that is not the reality of student life now. And we need to focus in on that and ask ourselves some serious questions about whether we want that kind of bifurcated class-based experience of higher education without choice. Clearly, there are students who might want to choose to work and do things, and we should build systems. And actually, we are very successful in building systems for students to do that. But and I think the government's acknowledgement in raising maintenance at the same time as fee, maintenance loans at the same time as fee, suggests that they have understood that the experience for students is not a kind of, yes, you need to do a bit of bar work so you can have a night out. It is you need to be consistently employed in order to be able to fund your studies. And certainly that wasn't the offer to students when I went to university 20 years ago. And you couldn't tell from the outside when I was at university by working patterns, certainly, who was from one class background or another. And I think that is less the case now. I don't think it's entirely disastrous, and I think there's lots of institutions doing lots of good work about it. But we are, you know, we need to arrest that before, if we want to arrest that, we need to act relatively soon. Otherwise, that will be the world that we end up with, and that will inevitably impact on outcomes.
So just going back to your first comments there, John, and I apologise, this is a horribly mean question, but there are some institutions who still tell their students that they shouldn't be working during term time. And given what we know about students working, I'm just interested in your thoughts on that.
So I think, as I say, I think institutions need to know their students. If they think they can build a world in which they don't need to work, that may be one of the offers that they want to make and the requirements they want to stimulate. But And it's not for us to tell institutions, it's not for us to prejudge how institutions do that, but it is to say, you have to teach the students that you took And you have to build around them the right thing. And my job is to say, you can't just avoid having to deal with those difficult things by not taking any of the difficult students. But I think one of the things, and actually just to come back very quickly to one of the points that Lee was making earlier about some of the challenges around any metric around social mobility or inclusion of disadvantaged and underrepresented students within higher education, is that we still haven't really found a way of representing the fact that there is all the difference in the world from having 10% of your student base come from households that are that just don't have the resources to support their students there, than there is to having 80% of your students. That's not an 8 times difference. It doesn't grow like that. And certainly one of the things we're thinking about in our work on funding, and we obviously fund much less than HEFCE used to of the sector now, so it would make less difference, but is ways of trying to reflect that. It is not, whereas if you look at the school system, we have a pupil premium. That pupil premium is the same for the child wherever they go and whatever institution they're in. But, you know, I've taught in schools that had, you know, literally 2 students on free school meals, and I've taught in schools that had pretty much everyone on free school meals. Those are 2 entirely different sets of challenges. And I think some way of representing that is really important. But absolutely, without engaging in a deficit model that says, you know, these students can't achieve, they're not expected to achieve. They can, they will, they need the support, but we need to be able to appropriately fund that. You can ask me another difficult question, Rose.
No, I'm not. I'm going to leave you alone.
Oh, good. Thank goodness.
We've got Megan. A question from Megan, and we're going to squeeze this in as the last question. And it is a question for the Vice-Chancellors on the call. So if I can go to Shirley, please. And then David, off you go, Megan.
For all of your contributions. I was just wondering whether you could kind of shed some light on the impact that the financial challenges in the sector may be having on those institutions that are performing well in the social mobility index, because I would anticipate that there are a number of institutions there who are performing well but are at risk of deficits and liquidity. So to hear about kind of how we can ensure that our efforts over the last years aren't set back by these new challenges.
So it's a really good question, isn't it? I mean, we're all having to make very serious attempts to prioritise what we spend our money on. We're having to reduce the cost base in our organisations. But obviously, those decisions have got to be made in light of what do we think is the most important thing for our students to succeed, and how can we make sure that our staff in doing that feel supported. So I think in taking costs out, it is a very, very difficult decision for us, but we've got to make sure that what we don't do is make the situation, it goes back to John's point, really. You know, we've admitted high numbers of students that have got significant needs to be able to get to the end of their programme and access good quality jobs. And we have to put a lot of interventions in to do that. We've got to try and protect that as much as we can. So I think being more connected, more streamlined, having better systems, but there's no doubt about it, some of the things that we will have to stop doing will probably be more in relation to the programs that we don't teach that have got low student numbers on them, the university research funding that we do that we probably need to pull back on in an attempt to really focus in on what matters for the students and their experience. So I think the priority area, this would be one of the things we would want to protect as much as we can.
Thanks. And a really quick answer from you, please, David.
I think the point that John made about the fact we could use the premium more effectively, I think, certainly worth looking at nationally. I'm not sure I agree with the assumption that some of those performing best are the most at risk, because actually those performing best will have higher continuation rates and they'll be helping those students through. Some of the institutions most challenged may be the ones that have got high proportions of students that aren't continuing. So they're being squeezed both on retention and recruitment. But irrespective, in truth, the sector cannot continue to function as it currently does with the current fee level and the current model. And that's not simply, the answer isn't simply to say to government, give us more money, when other international comparator countries are performing on lower levels of funding per student. I think there is a need for us as a sector to look at how we can adapt our business model whilst at the same time trying to protect what's special about the sector and the benefits we give. So I'm not sure I agree with the assumption on the higher ranking being more at risk in this table. But I do think there's a need for us to collectively come together and discuss alternative business models, and that's a whole additional webinar. And there's some really interesting work going on, I think, across the sector to try and do that at the moment.
Great, thank you. And I agree, that is a whole other webinar. We're going to wrap up there. I'd like to thank David for his work on the report, as well as Patrick Christie, who's been working hard in the background, and the wider LSBU team for collating the work and for asking HEPI to publish it. It is such an important piece, and we really are grateful to have a supporting role. And thank you to all the panellists for their time and expertise, and to Emma, Carol and the rest of the HEPI team for making this run smoothly. And thank you all for listening and for your questions. I'm sorry we couldn't get to them all. Please feel free to tag HEPI on Twitter if you want to continue some of the conversations. And I hope you all enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Thank you very much.